So hey guys, welcome to my channel, and as you can see on my screen, today's session is going to be part of my Kotlin basic series. Today we are going to talk about constructors. Yes guys, in my last video we were talking about creating class, and today we are going to talk about initializing the attributes or instance variables of a class using constructors. Before I start the video guys, I again want to request you to do subscribe to my channel, hit the bell icon for future notifications. If you have any questions, comments, suggestions for me, please put down in the comment section below so that I can address them. And give this video a big thumbs up. Please share it with your friends as well. And now without making any delay, let's get started with the video. So guys, as you saw in my last video, I created a class which is called as a student class. It basically has two attributes, name and marks. It has a method, a member function, print marks, in which we are printing the student name and the marks. And there is a main file here where we are creating the student and we are printing the marks, okay? So guys, as you can see on my screen that I have created a student object. So what I was doing previously, I was setting the name of the student like this, like name Rahul and marks says something. But what if I don't want to do it like this? What is a better way to do it? So what you can do guys, you can go to your student class and you can have a brackets here, and in these brackets you can define variable like name string, give some default value, like in my case I'm giving empty string, marks integer, give some default value like 0. And now instead of hard coding these default values here, we will just assign the name to name argument and marks to marks argument. Now if I go to main.kotlin class and if I just run this code, what's gonna happen guys? You will see in a minute on my screen. Yes, you can see on my screen guys that I see student empty string got 0 marks in their subject. So what we were doing before using hard coding the empty string and 0 value, now those values are being sent by our constructor. So the constructor which is created here is being called. By default the string is assigned, the name is assigned as empty string and the marks are assigned as 0. Instead of no values inside my class object, if I pass those values, for example if I pass the name Rahul and I pass the marks as let's suppose 60, now if I run my code you will see that I get printed student Rahul got 60 marks in their subject. So what happened here guys, basically the constructor got called, the name value was received as Rahul, marks value was received as 60. It simply assigned those values to my instance variables name and marks, and those instance variables got printed by print marks function. So did you see guys how easy it was to actually create a constructor? We can make this constructor much more concise guys. You basically don't even have to declare these variables, these instance variables like this. If you can just write the keyword var in front of the constructor arguments, by default Kotlin will take these constructor arguments as that of your instance variables. So if I run my code again, you will see that I will get the same output. You see, I get the same output. Now name and marks are by default our instance variables. Okay, now let's see one more concept guys. So if I want to pass a name variable but I don't want to pass the marks, I can simply delete the marks, right? And you can see that I'm not getting any error here. Why? Because the position of my name argument is position 1, it is at first position, and we are giving the name argument, so compiler will see, okay, so the first argument is being passed, which is fine, it is matching the data type of the arguments in the constructor, which is also fine. Second argument is not being passed, so let's take the default value of the second argument. Now if I run this code, what will happen? That I do get the name value as right, which is Rahul, but I get 0 marks. That means I'm getting default marks value. Now what if guys, I do not want to pass the name but I want to pass the marks. So let's suppose if I pass the marks as 60, will this code work? No, because you can see that there is a compiler error here. Basically, guys, if I hover over it, this basically says that the first argument which should be passed inside the student function should be of data type string. But I am passing an integer argument. That is why, because my compiler will expect that the order in which the arguments are being passed should match the order of the arguments stated in the constructor. If you are not passing the arguments in that order, or if you want to skip the first argument or the middle argument but you are passing the last argument, then you can do that by passing the name of the argument. So if I just write here marks becomes equals to 60, if I do the named argument, then you can see that I am not getting any compiler error. And if I now run this code, guys, it is going to run perfectly. Only thing is, it is taking the name value as empty string, but it is printing the marks as 60. So guys, if you do the name argument thing, you can even change the order of your argument. So I can give marks first and I can give name the next. So if I give the name Rahul as next, but I as a second argument, marks as a first argument, I can do that because I have mentioned the name of those arguments. So now you can see that my output is fine. So named arguments also helps us to improve the clarity of the code, guys. So I would recommend using name arguments, because if somebody is debugging your code and you know, they are not sure about the order of the arguments, they do not have to actually go to the class and check it. If they just see the name of the arguments here, then they will be pretty much, you know, they pretty much know that, okay, so this 60 value is actually the marks of the student and this Rahul is actually the name of the student, right? So that's why I recommend using the named arguments. So now you know, guys, how you can create a constructor, how we can use the default values of the constructor, and how the named arguments or the positional arguments basically work. The next topic of today's video is called as something init blocks. So what is an init block, guys? To create an init block, all you have to do is write init curly braces, and there you go. Now you can write any code inside this init block. So for example, init student class, okay? Init student class with name dollar name and marks dollar marks. Okay, so what does this init block do, guys? So for example, guys, when if you want to not only initialize some variables, I mean, if you want to initialize a variable, you can definitely use constructor, but you not only just want to initialize the variables, you also want to perform some action. You also want to maybe log some values, or you basically want to print something or do something at the time of initialization of your class object. So you can use the init block for that. So if you're using init block, all the arguments which were declared in the class constructor, you are able to actually access them using this init block. And if I now run my code, you will actually be able to see with what all arguments my class student was, my class student's object was initialized. So you can see that the first line now printed is init student class with name, the name which was passed, that is Rahul, and marks with the marks variable which was passed. So you can use this init block to do many things, guys. Let's say you want to open a database connection or a file connection, or if you want to, you know, log something, log the values which are being passed, you can use this init block to do anything. You can even have multiple init blocks. So let's say once you are done initialization, I can print like done init. So now if I run this code, what will happen is that first the init student class line will get printed, second the done init will get printed, and next thing is the last print marks function, which we are calling in the main.kotlin. Okay, so I hope, guys, now that thing is pretty much clear. Another really interesting thing with init block is that in init block, you can use all the variables which are mentioned in the primary constructor. So that is this constructor. Let's say if I create another variable here. So let's say variable last name string becomes equals to 12th. So let's say this is the class of the student. Now if I want to say that init student with name this and class, class name, and marks, marks. Okay. Now, if I run this code, guys, the first line should actually print that I have initialized init student with name Rahul, class 12th, and marks 60. And that is getting printed, right? Let's remove the second end block. That is not needed. But what if I remove this class name and instead of declaring it on top of the init block, I declare it on the bottom of the init block. Now you can see, guys, that I am getting a compiler error that this class name variable is not found and it is not initialized. So why I am getting this issue? Because there is a rule that whatever variables which can be accessed in the init block, either they should be part of the primary constructor, that means this constructor, or they should be at least declared and initialized before that init block. So if you are declaring all any variable after the init block, you will not be able to access it in the init block. Okay, so that's about init blocks, guys. I hope this is pretty much clear to you. And the next topic of this video is something called as a secondary constructor. So let me delete this init block, guys, and now we will go forward with the secondary constructor. First of all, you have to understand what is that. So let's go to the main.kotlin file, guys. Let me create some more students with this. So let's create one student called as Geeta with like marks 90, and let's say I don't mention the name of that student. Let's create another variable called as default student. So this is a student with all the default values. So it is having 0 marks and it is not having any name also. Okay. So now, guys, if I you can see that on my screen that I am able to create all these student objects and not getting any compilation error. Why? Because in Kotlin we have a concept of default values in your constructor. Okay, so I am having two variables, name and marks, and both are having default values. So if I mention marks and name both, that is also fine. If I only mention marks in, if I only pass marks in my constructor, that is also fine. If I don't pass any value in my constructor, that is also fine. So if you have worked in other languages like Java or Python or any other language, you might know that in those languages, there is a concept of constructor overloading. So in case of Java, let's suppose if you want to make this code work, you actually have to create three constructors inside your class. One constructor will have only default arguments. One constructor will have only one argument, which is of marks. And another constructor will have all the arguments, which is marks and name both. But in case of Kotlin, you do not have to create three constructors. You are able to do this entire job with only one constructor, because we have a concept of something called the default argument. So because if you don't pass anything or you miss any one of the variable, their default values will be considered by Kotlin. So that's why in Kotlin, you don't really need constructor overloading. But nevertheless, the concept still exists in Kotlin. So let's say I am not initializing this class name variable. Okay, let's initialize it initially with empty string. Let's say I'm not initializing it in any class name variable. I am initializing it not with the primary constructor, but I'm initializing it with secondary constructor. So if you want to create a secondary constructor, guys, you have to write constructor. And in this constructor, you can pass a variable called as class name string. And this dot class name becomes equals to class name. But you can see that we are still getting an error. So actually, guys, all the secondary constructor must call the primary constructor, or they must call the another secondary constructor using a this function. Okay. So what is this doing, guys? This is actually a call to your primary constructor only, but with the default arguments. Okay, so what will happen when we are going to call this constructor? It is first going to go to a primary constructor and add the name and marks with default values. So initialized name and marks with default values, and then it will actually call this code and you know assign the class name to this dot class name. So let's say student name got dollar marks in their subject. Student name from dollar class name got certain marks in their subject. Let's go to main.kotlin class, guys. As you can see that all these constructors are definitely working. So let me delete these values and now let's use the secondary constructor to create the Rahul student object. So student, and now we are able to use two constructors there. Either I can pass name and marks or I can simply pass class name. So I'll just use class name becomes equals to 12th. Now if I run this code, guys, you will see that the print marks function is going to print student from student dash from 12th A got 0 marks in the subject. So what happened was that your secondary constructor was called. It called a primary constructor with default arguments. That's why the name and marks are default. And then it assigned the class name to the class name value which was passed. You can also use, you can also have one more secondary constructor here. Let's take one more secondary constructor. And this is actually having name, string, marks, int. And then you can use these name and marks value in your this. That means what will happen when we will call this constructor, it will call the primary constructor with the name and marks to initialize those variables. And then it will call this class name becomes equals to class name to initialize the class name. So now what I can do, I can, you know, change this to class name, name becomes equals to Rahul. And marks becomes equals to, let's suppose, 70. So let's run this code, guys. And you will see that now it prints that student Rahul from class 12A got 70 marks in their subject. All the values got initialized using this secondary constructor. But do we really need the secondary constructor? I don't really think so, because we could have just used this class name as part of the primary constructor. And you know, choose to actually send it or not send it in our student object. Okay, so basically it's the functionality is there of constructor overloading, but I don't think you'd really need in case of Kotlin because you have the value the default value concept in Kotlin, so you don't really need this constructor overloading. Okay, but nevertheless, I think it is still clear to you. So the next topic of this video is something called as property getter and property setter. Okay, so I'm just deleting this secondary constructor, guys. I think those are clear to you. Now let's say how we can use a property getter and a property setter. Okay, so let's say I have got this, let's set the class name as let's remove the class name. Actually, yes, let's take some variable called as percentage. Okay, let's remove this also. So instead of printing the marks, let me print the percentage of the subject. The student with certain name got this much percentage in their subject. Now, what I want to do with this percentage value is I don't want to initialize it using my constructor. I actually want to calculate this value using some logic. Okay, so let's say my percentage is of type int. By default, its value is, let's suppose, 0. So by default, it's 0. But whenever anybody wants to get the percentage value, it is going to apply some formula into it. So what I'm going to do? I'm going to apply a formula that marks into 100 and divided by 100. So that becomes my formula. So whenever anybody is trying to get the percentage using this dollar percentage sign or student dot percentage, it is going to call this getter function, calculate the percentage value and then return it. Let's see how this is going to work. So now I don't have that constructor, so I only need name and marks. So let's say Rahul got 70 marks. Okay. So Rahul has got 70 marks, so definitely his percentage is going to be 70%, right? So let's say Rahul got 70% in their subject. Because what will happen? We call this getter function. It actually applied this formula and then it returned it. Let's say that the total marks is from not actually from 100, it is actually from 80. And let's make this instead of integer, let's make it double. Okay. And we also have to actually change it. Okay, let's not cast it now, it's not really important. Let's make it integer only. But you have seen what happened, guys. If you go to print this percentage variable, it is actually going to call the getter function and then it is going to print the value. Another thing you can do is something called a setter. So let's say I am getting this value. If I am trying to get the value, I'm actually, calculating using some formula. But if I am trying to set the value, so let's say if I set the value to percentage, then what I am going to do, I am actually changing the marks value. So if I change the percentage value, I am actually putting marks becomes equals to whatever is the percentage. Let's suppose whatever is the percentage, I am just doubling it. So if I am setting the value of the marks, I am setting the value of the percentage, I am actually doubling the marks. If you are setting the value using the setter, you don't need to use the equal to sign to set the default value, because then you are setting the value. Okay. So let's say this function is called as print percentage. And then I create another function which is called as print marks. So what will happen with this setter, guys? What will happen with this setter? That whenever I will set the value of the percentage, it is going to make some change in the marks variable. Okay. So let's say Rahul.printMarks. After that, I am setting Rahul.percentage becomes equals to, so let's suppose Rahul's percentage was 30%. Okay, let's not take 30. Let's say Rahul got percentage 80%. Then I'm going to print Rahul.print marks. And previously I'm printing Rahul's percentage. So let's run this code, guys, and let's see how it actually works. So you see what happened now. First of all, I printed Rahul's percentage. So Rahul's percentage was printed using the getter function, in which I passed 70 marks, so his percentage was 70%, which was calculated and printed here. Next, I set the Rahul's percentage to 80. So when I'm calling the setter, it actually calls the setter function, and whenever the value 80 was set, then marks becomes equals to, I change this very value marks to percentage into 2, or value into 2 actually. It should be value into 2. So if you do value into 2, that whatever value I actually pass, so I passed 80 here in the setter, and it actually multiplied 80 with 2 and it set the marks value to that value. Now if I call print marks method, it is going to print the name of the student and the marks of the student. So now you can see that the marks of the student became 160. Why? Because his percentage is 80, so 80 into 2 becomes equals to 160, and that becomes the setter and the getter part of percentage variable. So if you actually want to not the return the exact value and you want to perform some formula in it, you can use the getter function. if you are setting the value and at that point of time you want to, you know, do some extra work, you can use the setter function. Other than that, you know, constructors are pretty much okay to initialize all the variables. You can use the init blocks to do some extra initialization or some extra actions when you are initializing or creating an object of a class. And you can use the secondary constructors if you really have the need of constructor overloading. So that was a longer video, guys, but it has to be long because the part of constructors in Kotlin is a little bit complicated and a little bit longer. But I hope this video was clear to you guys, and now you are pretty good with creating class constructors and initializing attributes with it. Again, in the end, I request you guys to do subscribe to my channel and hit the bell icon for future notifications. If you have any questions, comments, suggestions, feedback for me, please put down in the comment section below so that I can address them as soon as possible. And also, guys, do not forget to give this video a big thumbs up, share it with your friends as well. I make your videos every day from Monday to Friday, so I'll see you guys next time. Until then, bye bye.